attention. The movie guys love movies. Any jokes about how the new thriller, No Escape, should carry the title Lee Daniels' No Escape are purely for entertainment purposes only. Isn't that right, Ray Liotta?
I'm going to jump right in.
That's deep.
What are you talking about?
Oh, I get it.
I don't.
It's the ongoing mission that Lee Daniels is full of shit.
Okay, I get that.
He had to call the butler.
Because?
He had to call the butler, Lee Daniels the butler, because apparently there was a short film in 1916 or something called The Butler didn't allow him to call his movie The Butler, so he called it Lee Daniels
name,
the butler.
Yeah.
Which is not true, because apparently movies like 1994's No Escape and the No Escape that comes out this week don't give a shit about this. So he's just sticking his name on the movie. That's what he's doing.
You realize No Escape, nobody remembers that. That is Ray Liotta's...
But nobody remembers The Butler, the first one.
This is the fourth No Escape movie. 1936 and 1953 also had No Escapes released for whoever wanted to see a movie called No Escape.
All right, so
there's also a Gladiator with Cuba Gooding Jr.
Crash, where there's, you know... the winning Best Picture and people having sex at car accidents.
Yeah, yeah.
I think you should just combine those. And you'd have everything you need. Anyway, Running Scared, Twilight, Flawless, Kicking and Screaming, Bad Boys. They do this all the time.
I was going to say you have no examples.
Bad Boys.
Matter of time till we see Lee Daniels' Empire on TV, right? He'll stick his name on that. Anyway, welcome to the Movie Showcast, part of the vast and sprawling Movie Guys Empire. That's a great outfit. How much do clothes cost in The Matrix? You've reached ground zero for all things movies and comedy. We bring the two together right here on our show every week with jokes, rants, sketches, characters, banter, bits, special guests, and more as we broadcast from the Admiral's Club in the heart of Burbank Airport's flyover zone. They don't stop making movies, so we don't stop making comedy shows about movies, which means you can get a new show every week at themovieguys.net, as well as iTunes, SoundCloud, Stitcher, Vimeo, YouTube, Player.fm, TuneIn.com. Poddirectory.com. There's plenty.
TuneIn.com, Paul. That's a new one.
No. Pod Directory is new.
Pod Directory.
Yes.
And wow.
They're just basically reposting something.
Sure.
So
I
mention them every once in a while.
Well, hey, sure. Please.
But if you like the internet radio, go to WBAD.net Fridays at 4 p.m. Eastern. Basically search the Movie Guys on Bing, Yahoo, or...
Google.
And we come right up. I'm your host for the hardest working comedy show in the airwaves, Paul Preston, here with Karen Volpe.
Janine, sorry about the bug eyes thing.
And Adam Witt.
Don't talk to me like that, ass face. I don't work for you yet.
Nice. No Bart Caius this show. He'll be back next week. Joining us in the second half of the show, however, is an actor, singer, and musician currently seen in the horror, sort of goth, kind of burlesque-y musical, Alleluia, the Devil's Carnival.
Awesome.
He's also appeared in School of Rock and SLC Punk. And, of course, he's known worldwide for originating the role of Roger Davis in the huge Broadway musical Rent. Adam Pascal will be
there. Damn. That's accomplished. Woo! That's pretty accomplished.
Oh, I left off some stuff.
Doesn't that make you tired just sitting there listening to that?
I feel unaccomplished.
I know.
Though if you want to feel unaccomplished, go to Cirque du Soleil. Watch the 10-year-olds that thing with the yo-yos. You've done nothing with your life.
And there's 10 of the little girls doing that with the yo-yo.
I did edit a campaign ad for D's Nuts for Maxim magazine. So,
boom,
drop the mic right there.
Very nice. Lots to talk about with Adam, but first... we're laser-focused on what's opening in cinemas with our patented previews of new movie releases. And if you're a studio looking for the right release date for that Owen Wilson political action thriller and that Zac Efron DJ with a Dream movie, might we suggest August 28th? This week sees Wilson paired with Pierce Brosnan. Oh, there he is. In No Escape. And up first, we are your friends.
Oh, yeah, and with friends like you, who needs friends?
Any successful artist, they have this moment where they stop being an admirer and they find their signature. Talents have soul. Build them from scratch. Find new ones. Get your head out of that laptop and start listening to what the real world is trying to tell you.
Oh, this is the Katy Perry movie, right?
Only. Get your head out of your computer and start finding your own sounds, Adam.
Yeah, that's what Katy Perry says in her IMAX movie, her IMAX 3D movie, right?
Sure.
Sure, I don't know. There's not as many tits in this, so that's too bad. Not
just
Katy Perry's
just a bunch of
tits.
Boobs. You see what I did there? We are comedy professionals, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh, my God.
We'll prove that eventually. I'll tell you where that... I'm not a big fan of that music, and we'll talk about that
later. Really?
What is happening
Really?
Here?
I'm a rock and roll guy.
Uh-huh.
But... It works for me in movies. What? I hear that in the trailer. I'm like, I'm psyched to see this movie.
Yeah.
You know, but, you know.
Well, it works in an EDM show.
It works in Blade. First time I ever saw it.
Yes. Yes.
Right? There's a dance club.
Oh, hell
music
yeah.
Going. And then the blood sprays.
Yeah, yeah, because then somebody gets shot or something happens.
Well, then there's a story and other things I care about.
And then they stop doing that. Like, if you had to sit in that club all night, you'd poke your eyes out with your fingers. Mm-hmm. Well, that's good.
Not EDM is the overarching description for them, right? Because if you say to someone who's into electronic dance music, if you go, oh, I love that techno. No, it's not technically techno. It's technically trip hop. No, it's not technically trip hop. It's techno.
I
don't talk.
I don't say it. I'm not going to say anything then because I don't want to start that conversation.
I think that's the reason texting is so big, because when you go to those places, you can't hear. So everybody's talking about each other behind their backs by texting, which is very strange.
Yeah.
That's why I don't go to concerts. I'm nervous that someone will try and talk to me in the middle of them, and it's absurd. Especially when I've been to a few EDM things, and someone that leans over and goes and yells in your ear.
And it hurts
because there's so much music. It's really hard to talk,
and you can't talk at all.
I just look at them like, why are you even? What do you mean?
Shouldn't be here if this is what you want to do.
Wait a minute, Adam. Didn't you go to the coolest thing though? The coolest thing ever, where everybody got headphones.
That was the best. If anybody's interested and like doesn't want to go to something like this, but wants to go to something like this.
Yeah, you physically. You want to be there, but you don't want to hear it.
It's called a silent disco.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They put on, they have two DJs. You put
Very
on,
cool.
Miss Victoria took me one of these, and you put on the headphones, and they have lights on the top, and there's a green DJ and a red DJ, and you can change it for which DJ, but you can also see who in the crowd's listening to and who they're dancing to, but you also adjust the volume yourself, and when you take it off, you can talk.
You can talk, because it's headphones.
I've heard of those, but
Very
you're the
cool.
only guy I know who's gone to one. I think that's
And you get
cool.
to choose, like if one kind of music is more like 80s or something you're into, you can just listen to that. Of course, it's weird, because everybody's dancing. Like, you're dancing next to someone who's maybe...
Oh, I would never have the headphones on. I'm going to see the show. Yes. I want to see the guy, you know, and then talk to my buddy about it.
I think
it's
really clever.
Then he has his headphones off. We just sit there and goof on everybody.
That's fun.
That might be fun.
All right.
Well, listen, our first film is We Are Your Friends.
We Are Your Friends. Shouldn't that be Lee Daniels' We Are Your Friends? Isn't that right, Leopold DeWolf? Right?
What?
Yeah. There was this other movie called We Are Your Friends. It was a short film from 2012. Aren't we doing that joke anymore?
No. Let's talk about the new Zac Efron film, We Are Your Friends.
We are your friends. Calling occupants of interplanetary
flights,
extraordinary craft.
What?
You don't know that song?
No one knows that song. The movie is set in the wild nightlife of clubs and parties with the young and the beautiful of Hollywood. So the biggest acting stretch for Zac Efron is that he's playing a 23-year-old, because, you know, he's actually 28.
That's right. The electronic dance music scene is about to get a whole lot hotter as Efron plays a struggling DJ named Cole.
Yeah.
Well, there's your first mistake. A lame DJ name. If you want to make it, try DJ Cole is Ice or DJ Cole Trickle to appeal to fans of Days of Thunder. Or DJ J or DJ JD. Anyway, let's play a clip.
Study halls, SATs, liberal arts, student loans, layoffs, bailouts, broken dreams. This is not our future.
Actually, that is your future. Mm-hmm. That and herpes. We're pretty sure herpes is also in your future.
DJ Cole Mountain seems to be frustrated, suffering in his career aside from being tan, good-looking, well-adjusted, and, of course, Zac Efron. Nothing says underground music quite like the star of High School Musical.
It's the classic story of a small town boy who dreams of life in the big city. Except the small town is the San Fernando Valley and the big city is Hollywood. So my suggestion for getting to the big city is you take the five,
maybe
right?
The
or maybe Cahuenga.
It depends. I go Cahuenga.
Well, it's a Hollywood Bowl.
Oh,
you gotta watch
go
the
Yeah.
Depends on time of day, Zach.
Yeah, because as always, when plotting the course for the big time, check Waze.
Sharing the journey with DJ Cole Ostomy are his entourage of friends, Mason and Turtle. No, sorry, Squirrel.
Squirrel, yeah. Squirrel. Things get complicated when DJ Cole Miner's daughter strikes up a relationship with the girlfriend of DJ American Beauty, played by Wes Bentley. Bentley is his mentor, the guy who showed him how to...
Put the needle on the record.
Yeah!
Put the needle on the record.
Yeah!
Put the needle on the record.
Yeah!
All right, enough of that, man.
The girl, DJ Double D, is played by Emily Ratajkowski. Raja Maladella Ding Dong. you know, Emily.
Emily.
We'll call her Emily.
Yeah.
In case you were wondering what it takes to make it as a professional DJ.
Professional rum-a-dum and ding-dong.
As a professional DJ, well, it's...
But if you're a DJ, all you need is a laptop, some talent, and one track. Is your ticket to everything. Yeah.
That's not really...
All you do is a little more than play MP3s, and somehow Zac Efron makes it look harder than it is.
That's right. All it takes is that one special sound. Maybe it's the sound of a spoon tapping a kettle, or a wet sock slapping against a plastic tub, or maybe the sound of your parents' hope that you'll ever amount to something just crashing to the ground.
There's very little at stake here. DJ Coleslaw is not a musician in the traditional sense. He's a DJ who's finding sounds for dance tracks. Like, it's not life or death. It's just a guy who hates his real job working at a computer all day and wants to mix beats so he can work at a computer all day.
He's not even producing something avant-garde to impress hipsters. He's just mixing noises and beats with a little hint of a tune. It's kind of like McDonald's of music.
It's the Rocky of movies that go...
DJing, the only profession people like Kim Kardashian can rightly make fun of.
There you go. That's...
Wow.
I will let you know there is an art to DJing, or so I'm told by all of my friends who like it.
There is not.
Well, maybe there. I don't know.
Well,
I've never
done it. Of
course
there is. I mean, it's like,
you
know.
It's got to be a thing.
It's not done while you're there, though.
What do you mean?
They're
doing...
It's not like they're taking requests.
Oh.
I've seen
they
DJs
put together
more than
an
once.
Order.
I've seen DJs more than once. And it was the same from beginning to end. It's they're playing an MP3 and pretending to do stuff. That button they're turning, nothing goes on with that button. We got one of them right over there on our mixer. Doesn't do anything.
Do you want me to go DJ the mixer and start playing some crazy sounds? You know, I like in this movie where they go around and they grab the sounds. They start
That's the weird thing. That's made up. What? The DJs play album. I mean, whether they do
now they're
whether
sampling
they do
music
live or whatever. Well, they're not even sampling. They're playing. Albums. Well, I guess they have. Sometimes they'll have one album on one side,
right.
And one album on the
other. All right. So I just saw not Run DMC. Who are those guys? Straight out of Compton.
DJ Yella.
N.W.A.
Yes, N.W.A. And I was impressed by that because they literally made the tracks that they were singing to. Like it was happening while they were there.
But they're taking old albums and things like that and using the samples.
I don't think that's what's happening now.
Well,
though.
I don't know. They actually did a lot of sampling.
No,
back
still
then.
Is.
But they do. I mean, there is a scene in the trailer where they're. He's nailing something.
Yeah, and
the girl runs her zipper up and down.
Oh,
and,
yeah.
And, they go, and
that's
he
what
uses
I mean.
That sound.
You know what? Yeah,
he does call those sounds and
that.
Make music out of it. And Howard Stern does this all the time when he's playing dance music. He'll play the sound of a door closing. And he play it in town with a beat.
Yeah.
Next thing you know, you're listening to a song.
Actually, I super take it back because one of the shows Victoria took me to was a DJ that did all the sounds live, and he would have reverberation. So he would hit something, he would bring out a bunch of stuff, and he would hit something, and then he would play that sound in a loop. I mean, he would play it into a machine that automatically loops it.
Wait a minute, I remember seeing something like that in a Prairie Home Companion. Oh. That guy who did all the sound effects, remember him?
Ah, yes.
No, I'm teasing.
Listen, I've shot a bunch.
He had a table full of stuff, and he made noise with it.
I've been hired to shoot with my camera.
Yes.
EDM events. The beat drops every 2 minutes.
There's like a recipe.
I timed it. Yeah. It's like do 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 do
by the way,
that happens every 2 minutes.
That sounded awesome.
They bring it down again.
Perfect.
They bring it down again.
Unless it's a trip
hop
show, Paul. Unless it's a trip hop.
Well, I don't know.
And then what?
More techno. Talking more techno.
But that's actually fun to do that build and that rise. I mean, if you've been to a Fatboy Slim or one of them popular ones or anything like that, they're really, I mean, you know, like that's the few I've
seen
been
guys,
to.
I've seen Vegas guys, you know, that's who I'm shooting when they come down.
Yeah, yeah. But I mean, that's a fun thing to be a part of, that rise and everything like that. And, but by the way,
but 2 minutes, I'm good for like
yes,
8 of those.
Yes, but by the way, I just want to say, because I do have 1 foot in this world, because I know some people who are big fans of it, and I've lived with DJs and everything like that, we sound like dickheads, because there is a ton of nuance to it, and let me just say what this sounds like to anybody I might know who would be listening to this. Rock and roll, that's the one where the guitar, it has this progression every time.
there's a chord, this chord,
then a multiple chord. Yeah, I get it. That's what rock and roll is.
Listen,
that's exactly how it sounds.
Zac Efron
right
and Squirrel and his buddies, whatever. They
oh,
can
well,
have
fuck
this
movie.
I do want to say. I do want to say.
They can have this. It's not for me. And I think I should lead with that.
Hang on a second.
And I gladly will. No. Not my thing.
I know all the lyrics to this song, though. I just want to say right now that it's sometimes hard to memorize lyrics, and I know how they go. Put your hands in the air.
Make some noise.
Make some noise.
There's a lot demanded of you.
Put your hands in the air.
When you go to one of these, it's all asked
of you. It's like they're going to take your wallet. They're like, put your hands in the air, and now hand me your wallet.
Yes.
But that's...
Here, let me show you how easy it is.
Person.
Wait, let me show you how easy it is. Okay. Because we listen to trailers all the time, right?
No, yeah.
And we pull sounds from trailers.
Oh, good. Did you put them together?
Well, I'm going to do it now. I'm not going to do it beforehand and play my MP3. Because what happens is you can't film these DJs from behind. I specifically get told with my camera not to do that. Because it would just prove that they're not doing anything. You can just say, here's an MP3 for you. I'll be over here sitting down. Enjoy yourselves. Have a nice night. But, you know, the whole turning the knobs. Anyway, I'm a dickhead, right? Is that what you said? I'll own that shit.
Oh, somebody hates this.
All right, here we go.
Are you doing this right now?
Yeah, I'm gonna use sound effects from trailers, the ones we know and love.
Okay.
They're all
good.
In the Hall of
the
Bong.
Ones we talk, Hall
right?
of Bong? Good. I'm assuming Bong's going to show up.
But here we go. This is
and a quote from Ed Wood.
I'm gonna play. Some.
So, what do you this call one, this? From, the bed? This part here?
This from Ouija.
Okay.
Okay.
That was good.
And you know this one from Transformers, right?
That's awesome.
Oh, I feel like something's
gonna
happen.
Do you have Godzilla? Oh, a little lazy.
I like how you have to bounce. Is that Godzilla?
Oh, that's just Dinobots running wild.
Oh.
What you got to do every 2 minutes?
Well, that's the buildup.
Oh,
well,
that
you have the one with
one.
The fart? You have the one from Oculus?
All right.
That's awesome.
Why aren't DJs funnier? Because this could be really funny. You could, like, sample in funny sounds and stuff.
DJ Wong.
Do they sample in fart noises?
See, you're enjoying this, Paul, right?
Yeah, you're smiling and bouncing.
You're doing something.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, that's true. You are trying to hit the beat and stuff.
Oh, music. That's disco, right?
So anyway.
That's what you sound like. That's what you sound like. Oh, I've heard music. It's disco, right?
Let me just wrap this up.
So old and grumpy.
What you saw there, you went 2 hours of that? We are your friends. There you go.
Okay.
Our next film.
I can't imagine a DJ who would go see Zac Efron
I
pretend to
be
one,
I bet he thinks it's annoying, too.
Come on.
Yeah.
You know what? Steve Schultz, who writes for the show, said, neither will people, because they could go and see a DJ.
Yeah, why not
or
go see
pay it? To see the drama behind the DJ.
Oh, yeah.
Who wants to see that?
Who cares?
Anyways, he'll be 30 soon enough, and we can cut the shit and see what he does next. Our next film, already in theaters, it opened on Wednesday to get a jump on the huge August 28th weekend.
Good.
It wanted to get in there before the other one took
no
off.
No escape. Adam, let's talk about it.
Oh,
here.
Have
oh wait.
Fun.
If I'm not careful, I'm going to play another sound effect.
Yeah, don't. Right, don't do
that. Now play Wong right there.
That's good.
You're getting good at this, Paul. I think you're going to be a fan.
Good news for xenophobes. Everyone in Southeast Asia is out to get you in No Escape.
No Escape tells the story of Jack and Annie Dwyer, played by Owen Wilson and Lake Bell.
Swing! All right.
Thank you.
I love the delay.
Yeah, well, the delay.
It's a lot to do.
Also, kind of half unenthusiastic
swing.
You didn't find one of the big
they're
swings.
They're psyched. It's like, swing. Kristen Bell, she's good.
Swing! All right.
The Dwyers, along with their young daughter, move out of the U.S., mistake number one, to a country named Southeast Asia.
When the citizens of Southeast Asia realize where they're living, they revolt, taking to the streets in violent opposition to not having American game shows and virtually no Kardashian news.
The Dwyers are caught in the crossfire of the bloodthirsty armies of orcs and stormtroopers. Oh, sorry, not orcs and stormtroopers, that's actually Southeast Asians.
Yeah.
Leading to this panicked call.
I think it was an Asian gang or something. I saw someone, he looked Asian, and he was speaking another language. I'm pretty sure it was Asian.
I hope they fry that guy.
Darn the luck. Isn't that always the case? You get tired of spacious and affordable housing and clean and quiet surroundings, so you decide to move your wife and two daughters to somewhere in Southeast Asia. And you pick the one place in Southeast Asia that isn't all socially stable and well-rooted in fair democratic governments. What are the chances? Well, here's a clip from the movie.
Wow, what the heck? There's a bunch of crazy people standing in our yard. Hey, hon, I think we're about to get murdered.
Might have been SNL.
That might have been. Yeah. Southeast Asia is kind of a big place. I mean, where in Southeast Asia are they exactly?
Ah, yes, good point. They don't say, but doesn't matter.
I guess not in this movie, it doesn't.
All right. Wilson walks the abandoned streets searching for help in the trailer when he sees two sets of armies marching from opposite ends of the block, clearly ready to fight, and then faster than you can say bottle rocket.
It sounded like it was about to bwong on its own there, right, at that moment in the trailer.
Yeah.
The movie then plays out like a suspense thriller with dangerous mobs around every corner, leaving no child left unthrown off rooftops. At least throwing that child seems to be the centerpiece of every trailer I have seen.
That must have been an expensive special effect because they show it a lot.
And then the first one, there's like they stop, like, will the child make it? And that was the end of the trailer. Like, all right.
Come to the theater to see what happens
see
next.
See if the kid splats on the sidewalk and you see the worst movie you've ever seen.
Seen immediately because that's going to happen right away.
They throw her and then...
Right. Wow.
Oh, he's got a whole soundboard.
Oh, I gotta get these. I gotta
screwed.
Get that. Gotta organize that. Let's see. Wilson teams with James Bond to escape Asia. So it seems like that would go well. But right. Apparently there's no escape. Well, we'll see about that. You know, sometimes movies like to say one thing then do another. You know, like how they call an Adam Sandler movie a comedy. Too soon to shit on Pixels? Am I?
No.
I forgot about Pixels.
I guess I was waiting for a sound effect there because that was such a good point. That was such a good point.
I blew it.
My mind immediately.
You know, like how they call an Adam Sandler movie a comedy.
I immediately thought of Punch Drunk Love. I loved him in that. How long ago did
you
do that?
You were the only one.
I liked All right.
You know those Adam Sandler movies like Punch Drunk Love,
Spanglish.
I liked it. Shut up.
How does it end?
I don't know.
Well, they don't escape.
What?
Yeah. Thanks a lot, title. Way to blow the ending. God, these titles give away everything. You know, just once, I might like to be surprised that there are Avengers in the movie, you know? At least have the decency to call yourself spoiler alert, no escape.
And that's No Escape, everybody.
Wow.
Sponsored by the North Korean Board of Tourism. There you go.
So I want to see this. I like Owen Wilson. I will see this movie.
You know what's amazing about him?
I bet you he
will be completely credible in this movie.
That's the thing.
It seems like the last guy who would be.
I love him in the Wes Anderson movies. I completely buy everything he does. And this is such a different genre. And I already am excited.
So you will go see an Owen Wilson movie just because he's in it? Just because?
Yeah,
do you think he elevates movies? Because...
He warm fuzzies them for me.
Okay.
So when I go to a movie with him, it's like going to...
He makes them approachable.
Yes. It's like going to the store and getting your comfort food. So I go, gee, I want to watch a movie, but I want to make sure there's someone in it that I like. So I would see a Sandra Bullock movie, but I've seen all those. So the second person would be Bill Murray, but I've seen all those like 15 times.
So in your estimation, to use
so
the...
I would go see Owen Wilson because I like him for two reasons. One, I like him, and I can't stop staring at his nose.
It's true. He never had it fixed.
I love that. I love that about him.
You know what's so funny? I watched a bunch of 80s movies with my mom over the... I was on vacation for a little bit, and... Man, they didn't fix their teeth in the 80s. They just didn't even...
And they were yellow, too.
No, yeah, exactly. Yeah. They didn't whiten them. They didn't fix them. They were just... I don't know.
Meryl Streep, hers are different now. I was watching a Meryl Streep movie, and her teeth are messed up.
You can't find a bad grill now.
It's
like,
amazing.
It's a requirement. Isn't that interesting, though? You'd think maybe even in the 80s and early 90s or whatever, it's like, there would have been some pressure to make them not yellow.
Sandra Bullock and Speed, hers aren't fixed.
Yeah.
But I think that's kind of, you know, it's amazing that that is something that's happened in 30 years, the fact that your teeth have to be perfect.
Yeah, and I feel like such a jerk because I totally notice, too. Because I'm like, I'm not that superficial guy. Like,
sometimes I notice in period pieces when, like, you know, they're in the filthy Civil War or something, they have perfect teeth.
Yeah.
That kind of stands out.
Foreshadowing, too, when Adam comes on, there was one thing that I remember when I first moved out here and I was doing theater. One of the critics wrote, they said, L.A. theater is so vapid. When I do Les Mis, they have manicures. Like, the girls that are playing the whores apparently had manicures.
Yeah.
Oh, well. I guess they couldn't commit to having crappy nails.
Couldn't commit to going and whoring out at night.
Apparently.
Hey, we just closed 9 to 5. I had 70s mustache and sideburns for 2 months.
Oh,
he
had
to put up with it.
You
look better. You shaved. Yeah. Thank God. I shaved, too, once the show was over. So we're
equal. Well, you're just Italian, so that.
Yeah, what are you going to do?
Did you videotape removing the mustache? That was a big thing.
Oh, no. You should have periscoped it.
I did it so quickly. Yeah. I just did it.
It came off like that.
I went, well, good night, everybody.
Showing down.
To the bathroom.
Yeah. So, yeah, I will see this. Because movie pass. Because you can.
Ray Scalacci of themovieguys.net, reviewer, saw it, sent me a review. Haven't been able to post it yet.
And?
I will post it tomorrow. And he loved it.
Oh, okay.
And then he followed up because he started reading all the reviews and they're like, the critics don't get it. Like you always
say,
they're watching the wrong movie. Yeah. Or they're watching the movie wrong.
Yeah, you're watching it wrong.
They
it's
expect
on you. You
something.
Have to do some work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, one thing that I got from the trailer that made it exciting to me is it has a very Walking Dead feel to me. Because I don't know if you're like me, but when you watch The Walking Dead.
Walking Dead, but Asians.
So you're watching The Walking Dead, and I'll just make up something. They go into the grocery store, and they're getting their supplies. But then you see the zombie coming over here, and then you know that the zombies are going to come through the roof. So then you have to figure out what you would do. Like, who would you sacrifice? What would you do with the mop that you grab, right? So as I watch this trailer, I'm like, okay, we got crazy Asians coming from over there. My family's over there, and I got to get upstairs. And then when I get upstairs, what would I do? And then it becomes very...
Throw your kid over there.
I'd throw my kid. I don't know if I'd...
Not a kid throwing.
I would
right?
probably just leave my kid and be like, I'll be back. But
it's a survival instinct. You just pick up your kid and throw him.
It's a choose-your-own-adventure movie. So I would figure out how I would do it.
I think Lake Bell, we'll see how her teeth look because, she's lovely. Mm.
She's lovely. Shwing.
I urge any male in our audience.
Yes.
And I apologize to the females.
What?
Shwing. All right.
Do enter the search term Lake Bell nude. My God.
What?
Enter
really?
That in Google.
Wait,
my
have you seen
goodness.
In a World?
No, I haven't seen In a World. I do like her, but
I didn't
I'm
get
not
that wrong, right?
That's yet. No, that's what it's called.
Fantastic.
Yeah, because her father was a real voiceover guy.
Oh, it's really
so
great.
Yeah, actually, yeah.
It's women empowerment, too, so that's why it's surprising to me that she'd be all naked and kicking around the internet. But what are you going
to
do?
Well, you're allowed to be naked. That's the thing. That's the thing. That's a two-way
if
street.
It's your choice.
I mean that's the thing. There's you can go two ways with that. If you're nude, then it could be sexist that you had to get nude in this movie, unless you do it confidently. I don't know how that works.
Tell us about when you get nude in a movie, Adam.
You know where I stand on EDM, but I'm gonna go on record also.
Yes.
And say I support Lake Bell doing it either way she cares to.
Yeah.
I will be there for both ways. She cares to present herself.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Clothed
I'm sure she's
or a non-clothed.
She has this whole message in the movie about women finding their voice, their true voice, and then you guys talk about
that film
naked.
Is well done and well directed. She directed that movie.
Just saying. Go. Anyway.
Well, I don't think women should ever be naked. Oh, wait, but that's also the mother figure. So I think they should always be naked. See,
wait, that's creepy.
I can't win.
Now I'm creeped out about people's mothers being naked. All right, good call, good call.
All right, listen, as I mentioned earlier, there is much to talk about with our guests, so we're going to take 10 seconds of break. That's it. Just 10, so hang out with us. We'll take a longer break. But for you, it'll only be 10 seconds.
All right, team, break.
With Adam Pascal in studio, stay with us. I messed that up. I was miming the keyboard and singing as if Greg Jafria and David Glenn Isley were the same person. David sang and Greg
you should know that.
Played the keyboards. Okay, so anyway. Hey, we're back. And psyched to be joined by an actor and fiercely talented singer who has a couple of albums of his own and can be currently seen in Alleluia, the Devil's Carnival, which is currently touring the country. We'll get to that.
Oh, cool.
And as well as the 2005 film version of Rent, where he reprised the role of Roger Davis. He made famous on Broadway. He's also appeared on Broadway in Aida, Memphis, and more. Adam Pascal, everybody.
Yay! Hey! Thank you, everybody. Hello.
You're a real actor.
Thank you. Well,
I know, right?
Depends who you ask.
Well.
Are you known for plays at all? You ever get out before you made it in musicals and do...
No, believe it or not, the way I actually got into doing musicals and the way I became an actor ultimately was I grew up in New York City playing in rock bands. And so in 1995... the band that I had been with since I was probably 12 years old, playing music that sounded, interestingly enough, a lot like that horrible Jafria that you play. So we had broken up, and I got a call about this off-Broadway musical that was being put together at the New York Theatre Workshop, and they were having trouble casting this particular role of Roger, and he was a rock singer, and they had opened the casting call up to people who didn't necessarily have any prior acting experience. And so I just kind of went in and, on a lark. I had never auditioned for anything before, and
Awesome.
It was really,
and don't get used to that, by the way.
Oh, believe me, it was the best audition I ever had, because I had no expectations,
right.
And had no idea what I was in for. And so I just had to go in with my guitar and play a song, and I just kind of went in on a lark. I'd never auditioned for anything before, and it just seemed like, okay, well, if I'm ever going to audition for something, it might as well be something that I actually know how to do.
Exactly.
And kind of just went from there, and then the show became huge.
You have such a great quality in your voice, because when I heard you when you did the Real Love music. We worked together
yes,
on that.
Yes, we did.
And
we
that
did.
Didn't
I'll leave it to you to describe what that monstrosity
please.
Was.
Now you, please explain
yes.
everything,
oh,
but don't just make a reference. Real Love.
All right. So,
and what was that show? I mean, come on.
Okay.
Yeah, we're going down a Broadway wormhole.
Well,
yeah.
I know, but I'm just saying, like, maybe people don't understand.
Well, before,
oh, you're right. Nobody understands,
and that
including all of us who were in it. Yeah.
Here, let me fill in the gaps. And the show was?
The show was The Real Love.
The Real Love.
Okay.
At the Pasadena Civic Auditorium.
Okay.
Yes.
And what happened, as far as I knew, is they flew in the leads from New York. So they had Katie Huffman from the producers, and they also had Adam, who was living here, who didn't have to be put up in their housing,
that's
which
right.
is good. And then Robert Torti came in, and then
and Daisy Egan
who I think was living here too, and they did the leads, and the rest of us did the chorus parts, and it was all based on the writings of the Supreme Master Chiang Hai.
What?
I'm not making this up.
No.
I'm not making this up.
A vegan guru.
That's exactly what you would describe her as.
They wrote
it about her life. In Southeast Asia.
Yeah. Yeah.
Appropriately.
This doesn't sound interesting to
and
me at all.
Don McLean.
Oh, it wasn't.
Do you have music from it? Don't play any of it.
More
no, that's
oh, God.
That's
I'm like, don't. What I was getting at before I started talking about the weird thing we did together. Was that when they did that music, it was, you know, whatever, it was very musical theater-y, that's great. But when I started listening to some of your stuff, because I never really paid, I wasn't the generation of Rent, I think I was more of the generation of Big River, because I like that kind of music, I'm such a dork. But your quality of your voice, I could totally see why, when these musicals started being more rock and roll and more that, you have such a great rock sound, and it's not put on.
Thanks,
it's because you're really a rock singer.
Well, I, you know, I grew up listening to 80s metal.
Yes, absolutely.
Jafria.
So, which rock sound do you have? Are you Queensryche? Are you
I would say
for sure.
I would say I'm the bastard child of
Bruce Dickinson.
Bruce Dickinson, yep. Jeff Tate, and Ronnie James Dio.
And it's solid.
Yeah.
And it's badass.
I'll take that combo.
Yeah. I would like to consider myself.
And I feel that the Real Love did not capture that.
Well, Lord. You know, it doesn't. You know, but then, you know, as I got into doing more musical theater, as a singer, you start to and getting the opportunity to do musicals, I started to discover these other parts of my voice that I never had the chance to express and never even realized were in me. Mm-hmm. And once I started doing more traditional things like cabaret in Chicago, I found how much more
fun. You have to dance in Chicago.
Yeah.
Oh,
absolutely.
Nice.
But it's that kind of stuff to me, because I played rock music for so many years, at this point now in my career, I find it so much more interesting and compelling to do that kind of stuff, you know, the more traditional kind of sound.
Mm-hmm.
It's, you know,
easier
on the pipes.
I was just going to say, because you can do the longevity of that, it's a little easier. Yeah.
Do you have a song in? I don't. But let's pretend I don't know Rent.
Yes.
Is there a song in Rent that is a rock song, like a rock and roll song? Because I think of that as the songs I've heard are fairly musical.
The songs
musical
are more rock than
the
musical theater.
The score was a combination, sort of a mashing together of the composer Jonathan Larson's idea of rock and roll and his influences of rock and roll, and also his musical theater influences. And so, so the score is considered a rock musical score.
Okay.
It's not rock musical in the sense of like
a rock,
you know,
musical
of like Green Day, like, you know, they did their rock music.
Their,
like,
it's not,
yeah,
rock.
It's not the kind of rock music that one would hear on the radio. It's it's musical theaterized rock music.
So think Glee and then think rock.
Jesus Christ Superstar.
Now that, have you done that?
I have not done that.
Oh, that would be sweet, dude.
Yeah.
Be great.
Although, speaking of Devil's Carnival, Alleluia.
Yes. Oh, we're supposed to talk about that.
One of my co-stars in the movie is Ted Neely, who played Jesus in Jesus Christ Superstar.
We saw him.
Did
you guys have a belt
separation?
Did you have a belt off? Just like, he's 62 now?
He is, and he's still got pipes has an amazing voice. He sounds terrific. He really does.
We just heard a story about him coming into the rehearsal hall. Who was telling us that? I can't remember. But they were rehearsing with him. They couldn't believe that they were on tour with him, and he wasn't in the rehearsals. And so they were doing all this, and the kid was just kind of like in his early 30s. So he's like, well, I'm kind of suspicious if his voice is still going to be good and whatever. So they were at some point in the show.
Oh,
where
they were at Gethsemane, right?
Yes. Where he just goes, ah, and he comes in. So they're all rehearsing, and they hadn't met him at all yet, and the door pops open exactly the right time, and he comes in singing the note. And they're like, well, it's going to be fine.
Yeah.
He just, in street clothes, putting his jacket down, just singing.
Well, he's still doing the show in various productions around the world. You know, I mean, he's nonstop.
That's going to be you, my friend.
I hope
you're going to be doing Rent. You're going to be 80 years old doing Rent. Going, I don't want to pay
you
Rent.
Still do
Wait.
Rent?
No, I mean, you know, look, I would imagine Jesus is somewhat ageless. And so Ted, of course, can play that part. I think me playing Roger, my days are over.
Yeah.
2007, 2008, you and Anthony came back, right, and did the show.
Yeah,
and
we did.
That was the final.
We did. Well, actually, we did. Anthony and I did a summer in 2007 on Broadway. And then we did a national and international tour in 2009 for a year.
That's fun, though, when you know a part really well.
Yeah, it was
great. Then you can enjoy yourself.
And I have to say, getting to close the Rent chapter in that way was so rewarding, because when we first did the off-Broadway production, for those of you who don't know much about the
Adam?
Show...
Yeah. No, nothing. Well, go ahead.
The composer Jonathan
First,
Larson
there's
died.
Batman. Oh, sorry.
He
died on our the night of our open dress rehearsal before we opened off Broadway.
He was very sick too during that whole time.
Well, he actually wasn't. He had a syndrome called Marfan syndrome, which had not been diagnosed. But basically, he had an aortic aneurysm that nobody knew about, and he basically just dropped dead.
Oh my God! So it was out of nowhere. Wow. I thought he had been suffering the whole time.
No.
Oh my God!
No. So that whole original production was so bittersweet, because the show took off and became so immensely popular, but yet he died, and so there was a lot of heaviness around that original production. So to come back in 2009
there was a
huge distance, mm-hmm. and all of that drama and heaviness had been dissipated and alleviated, and we got to do the show in a much more happy circumstance.
Who was the original casting director?
His name is Bernie Telsey.
Oh, Bernie Telsey.
Telsey.
Okay.
There you go.
He's a Broadway guy. And Adam, I will tell you, I could tell you he knows what he's doing just from.
He had Adele Dazeem in there.
Feel like it is resume, but this original cast, it has people that are just so.
Tay Diggs.
What's the word?
Tay Diggs.
What's the word I'm looking for? Oh, established.
Yeah. It's kind of like back in the day when. Let me put it in terms Adam will understand. Remember when in Toronto they did Godspell and it had Martin Short and Gilda Radner and Eugene Levy and Dave Thomas.
I know that from reading
that happened.
City, yeah,
that happened in the late 70s, and that. Same idea with Rent. The guy cast all these people that became huge.
So it was Idina Menzel went on to do Wicked and Frozen.
Yeah.
And it was Taye Diggs, of course. And Jesse L. Martin went on to do Law & Order for so many years. Rosario Dawson.
Oh, yes.
Right? Who was in the movie, not in the stage production.
Is that true?
That is true.
Oh, I thought she was in the original.
No, she was not. She was just in the film. The original Mimi was Daphne Rubin Vega.
Now, I remember it was a big deal when the movie came out that generally when they adapted stage plays to movies, they went and they never used the stage people. Like, what do those people know about acting?
No.
Why would we do that?
We would stay on Broadway in New York, you amateur.
We can't possibly have Katie Huffman doing the part of the producers that she wanted Tony for.
Of course.
But that was a big move.
Yeah, no, it was huge. And the idea of doing a movie had gone through numerous incarnations, numerous different versions of the script, numerous different directors were attached at various different times. There was at one point Spike Lee was going to do a version of it. It's my understanding that they approached Justin Timberlake at one point to play the part
that would be your part, right? Yeah.
Various combinations of people. The only reason that those of us from the original cast that ended up in the movie. The reason we ended up there was because Chris Columbus, who ultimately directed the movie, wanted us. And that was the only reason we were there. It was because he loved the show, he loved our performances, and he wanted to put us in the movie. And so
that's awesome, because that does not happen enough.
Chris Columbus having a good opinion is extremely rare.
Now, wait a minute.
Way off the mark, generally.
I was just putting the movie posters up tonight.
I'm kidding, you produce Pixels. That's a bad example.
Bad example.
You leave my friend Chris.
That's right, come on.
Sorry. punching bag.
So now going back to the movie that you were
Mrs. Doubtfire, Harry Potter. Okay.
I was just going to say that. Yeah.
Cleanse the palate.
When I was putting up the movies, Gremlins. I had to go into
Goonies.
Right. I had to go into the M's because I was putting up Mamma Mia, and I saw Chris Columbus's name on the bottom of a poster, and it bothered me so much I pulled out the poster and looked at it. It was Mrs. Doubtfire. Yeah. I did not know he did that comedy.
No, he did plenty of good stuff.
That is cool.
He just did some shitty movies that are fun to make fun of. What can I say?
I would have to say that a lot of people would put Rent on that list. You know.
Oh. Did he direct that?
He did. Yeah.
Oh, he did direct that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. It was, you know, it was great fun making it. And you know, I have to just want one thing I want to say about the movie is that what I'm most proud of is that when I was growing up, although being a huge rock and roll fan, I was a huge fan of musical movies.
Yeah.
And one of the movies that had the biggest impact on me as a kid was Hair, the film version of Hair.
Yep.
And the thing about that movie was that it had a very similar the public had a very similar reaction to that movie when it came out as they did to Rent, meaning that it was very sort of mixed reviews. Some of the fans loved it, some of the fans hated it. It didn't do particularly well at the box office, but it changed my life. And I meet people now that have only seen the film version of Rent, and they say that kind of thing to me. And so I'm proud that there are some people that are affected by it in the same way that I was affected by Hair, which lots of people didn't like, but lots of people did. So,
and you eventually got to do Hair, correct?
No, I have not done.
You never done it? Never did?
I have not. No.
Oh.
Oh well, we're just casting you all sorts of things. We're like, well, here's the deal. First of all, Jesus Christ Superstar.
For his career,
Hair.
He might as well be in everything.
you ever do a Hello? You ever play Dolly? Hello, Dolly.
Yeah. I would love to do that.
You'd be fantastic.
You did that. No, you did that.
Yeah, he did that. He went after Crazy Time, the musical that we were in. he went and did Memphis. That music is that more like. That would be the movie music of the 60s?
Well, it was written by, interestingly enough, David Bryan, the keyboard player from Bon Jovi.
Yeah.
That's
oh, nice. So what was that?
Did you get to work with him?
I did. He's a great
guy. Cool. Okay.
Yeah, there's actually a video of he and I, me singing and him playing one of the songs from the show.
Awesome.
But it's 60s and 50s inspired, but it's his version of it, you know.
Yeah.
He wrote a really wonderful score, really beautiful.
I have to check that out. I want to check that out.
I haven't seen it, but I'm very excited to know that it's not a jukebox musical.
No,
that
it's all original music, and really, he did a great job.
Yeah. That's cool. Yeah. And working with an 80s rock star.
I know.
What was your band called?
I don't even want to say.
Got to be better than Sweet Ass Cream Corn.
Shut up.
I don't know about that. Well, we went through many incarnations, and as with most unsuccessful bands, we blame the name very often.
Well,
it's the name. So we would constantly change the name because, of course, it's not the music. It's the name. So I can tell you that we went from, I'll start back in like eighth grade. So we went from like Enforcer to Rude Awakening to Wine and Vision. To Mute.
Wait, you weren't even old enough to drink at that age.
No, of course not. and I think I was
Mute!
At
Corrupt, I like
Corruption Mute. With a K. That was always very important.
Nice.
Corruption with a K.
Awesome.
Stick it to them.
Yeah.
There's no better way to stick it to someone than use the K instead of a C.
Of course, yeah. So we went through very many incarnations of horrible names, and you know, which was appropriate for our horrible music. So.
And who was your favorite band back then?
It was Iron Maiden. It was always Iron Maiden.
Really?
Yeah.
I never got that hard. I went Van Halen.
Yeah. I was a huge Van Halen fan, but once I heard Number of the Beast, I was like, oh my God. It changed my life.
I've never seen them live. Did you get to see Eddie and everything live?
Oh God, I saw them like 10 times. Are you
damn.
Kidding? Yeah. First concert I ever slept out for at Nassau Coliseum was Iron Maiden Power Slave.
Oh my God.
So that's when you can actually buy tickets at face value and get down on the front.
Oh yeah.
Nice.
Yeah,
yeah now you do that and you're still going to be up in the nosebleed.
No, I think I paid $40 for like 10th row.
Yeah.
Now scalping's legal.
Right. It's called StubHub.
Yeah.
So you're. Let's get to Alleluia.
Yes,
the Devil's Carnival.
Yeah.
For those of you, let's give a little history first. Terrence Zdunich.
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 Yes.
Oh, it's Zdunich.
Yeah. Right, there's a big old Z in the beginning.
I've only seen it in print, so I wasn't sure. He was behind Repo: The Genetic Opera.
Right. With Darren Lynn Bousman, the director.
Yeah, correct. And those two continue to collaborate because they made The Devil's Carnival, and now this is the sequel to The Devil's Carnival called Alleluia.
That's correct.
The Devil's Carnival.
Right. The first Devil's Carnival was not actually a full-length feature. It was about 50 minutes long. But I think the idea was always to turn this into a trilogy. of some sort. And so this was this is the second installment. It's a full-length feature. It's bigger. It's louder. There's more music. It's much more eclectic. It's just a much bigger production. And my character, who was not in the first film, appears in this film as the right-hand man of God.
Is that still Paul Sorvino?
Who's played by Paul Sorvino.
Cool.
Yes, absolutely. And basically it's heaven and hell are at war with each other, and the devil decides that he wants to sort of fuck with God. And so what he decides to do is all the condemned souls that God has sent down to hell, he decides to throw them on a train and send them back to heaven.
See, that's what happened at the end of the other one. That's right. Why he popped up and he's like, what are you doing here?
Yeah. Right.
There's not a lot of God in the first one. The mm-hmm. the first Devil's Carnival is a bunch of people going to hell and then having to relive their worst moments kind of and suffering.
Like what maybe got
them
there.
You kind of get the idea of how bad the devil is. And then he gets this idea.
And he's like, I know how I'll get rid of some of these people. I'll send them to heaven.
Yeah.
And also you see a lot of sort of the backstory of how some of those people in that first movie ended up getting to hell. Mm-hmm. And so my character is sent down to hell to quell this rebellion from the devil, and also to seduce one of these souls that has come up to heaven to see see if she is pure enough to remain in heaven, which ultimately she is.
That
not.
Sounds like you're setting her up for failure.
Well, yeah.
Come
in
on.
A way, in a way.
And I mean, here's the coolest part.
Yes.
The movie is not trying to represent heaven and hell. It's more or less presenting this entire show, I think, if it runs like the first one did. We weren't seeing heaven and hell. We were seeing a carnival.
A carnival, yes. Really
and
cool carnival.
And a burlesque type show.
Absolutely.
That was presenting you really sort of cool, ethereal
versions.
It was
like watching a cabaret. Absolutely, that's true. Like watching a stage play, but really well-filmed stage play.
Yeah, and heaven is portrayed as sort of like a 1930s movie studio. Mm-hmm. And it's there's different people doing different jobs, and there's lots of intrigue going on, and people spying on each other, and all sorts of things. And the lines between what's good and what's bad, what's evil and what's not evil, are very blurred. So you kind of get an idea that like heaven isn't so great and hell isn't so bad, and so the those lines get.
It's kind of like the Pixar movie that's out right now.
Inside Out.
Inside Out. Yeah, where we
that
start
was a great movie.
Great movie where you start to see the lines of.
I loved it.
Your personality and who you are. You have to balance bad things and good things. And you can't always be happy, so you can't always be good.
That's true.
But you can't always be bad. Oh.
Right.
This devil and God, they're gonna have to learn.
They're
to
gonna
work
have
together.
To learn they to work are. It out. That's all I'm saying.
Well, look, we've talked about Adam singing. Let's play a little bit.
Yeah,
of this
yeah.
is Down at the Midnight Rectory.
Yes, sir.
I found this out there. And,
oh, cool.
Let's take a taste.
Down, down, down at the midnight rectory, we jiggle juice frisking under the marquee. The peacocks are strutting behind velvet rope, sipping away on the heavenly dough.
Thank you for enunciating, by the way.
Absolutely. Musical
you.
Theater. Enunciation. Enunciation.
Somebody wrote those words, you know? Oh, it's so Big Bad Voodoo Daddy.
Yeah. Well, it's funny you should say that because Big Bad Voodoo Daddy is the band playing on the soundtrack.
No kidding.
Yes.
Okay, because I was going to say, this is
That's
the most upbeat song. This is more upbeat than any song from the first
the
one.
The first one is not
so
this.
You can tell already.
Actually, if I'm not mistaken, the composer, a guy named Sar Handelman, did not write the music for the first one. And so Terrence and Sar wrote the score to this film, and it's extremely eclectic and really interesting, and actually it's somewhat of a different musical vocabulary than most people are used to, so it's really exciting.
Good, that's cool. I that sounds fantastic. And Adam, you should hear him when he does some rock singing. It's a crazy
mm-hmm.
time.
I can hear it in that, and I do like this eclectic style because that is a fun. Hell of sort, like that is
well,
a fun
let me play
carnival
a little,
atmosphere.
Right.
You know,
let me play a little more. Then this is a clip from the trailer, and you can hear sort of some of the other music that's more hellish that is also found in this whole world that Terrence has put together.
Fascinating.
Can I tell you about my plan? I'm starting a war with God, that divine pretender. But first, I've selected a story for the occasion.
So anyway, so then that's the devil saying, you know, giving us his plan.
Yeah, that's definitely not as zoot-suity and boogie-in.
And it's very macabre. It's mm-hmm. I mean, it does fall, I think, somewhat into the horror genre, because Darren Lynn Bousman, the director, is known as a horror director. He directed mm-hmm. Saw 2, 3, and 4. So he mm-hmm. and
now Adam's and like, yes.
I know, that's why I know Repo Genetic yeah. Opera.
Right. And I knew exactly. Saw 2, film 3, and 4. And also the remake of Mother's Day. And so he's a horror guy, and he's a really, really great, innovative filmmaker.
It has a very Rocky Horror feel about it, the first one when I saw it. That's the other thing yeah. it reminded me of, because that whole sexy
and
kind
colorful
of
characters yeah, and makeup.
Yeah. And the hair and the yeah, I love
and
the
gleefully being violent.
Very violent and happy right. about it. Absolutely. Yeah. And
there's
being,
nothing like it.
Being strange but not having a problem with it. Yeah, lots of great. Oh, that's the other thing. As soon as I got done watching the first one, I said, there are a lot of great Halloween costumes in there.
Well, what's great about the movie itself,
which I like,
you know, the movie goes on tour. It's not.
Oh, yeah, what were you talking about?
Well,
touring.
The film does not have a traditional opening in the sense of the way other movies open, and then they get released to theaters and people can go see them in various theaters in their towns. What Darren did with the first one and what he's doing with this one is that he's touring it as almost as if like a live band would tour. So it's going from city to city, and the movie's being shown, and along with the movie there are it's sort of a very carnivalesque atmosphere. There's opening acts, there's sort of you know
fun.
Fire breathers and all sorts of
yeah,
fire
local music I think wherever he goes
exactly
right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh,
so
that's
so
such a smart idea.
And people come and they dress up and they dress up like the characters and they try
it's
and make
very
a,
Rocky Horror
yeah they try
that's
and make
fabulous.
A night of it so I'm looking
you know,
forward to
all,
joining it.
It's oh, are you gonna?
I'm gonna go to a couple of the.
Will it just
stops,
be unannounced?
Yeah.
So all of a sudden,
no. Well, actually, there are the, at various different stops. They have some of the actors from the films doing Q&As after the film, and
that's
so
really.
Yeah.
Well, I should say
fun.
Tonight it's in Albuquerque, but
oh.
we're taping.
And well, you're not there.
Dallas
yeah.
and New Orleans, but if for the LA area where we are, that's September 26th, Santa Ana on September 24th. And then in between there, San Diego on, I believe, the 21st. Back in L.A. to close the whole thing out, October 18th.
Are you going
to
do the October 18th?
Oh, wow. For Halloween.
Yes, as a matter of fact.
It makes sense to have you close it out. I'm just
yeah,
saying.
No, I will be there.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I have to go to that. I know a guy on the inside. I know a guy on the inside.
So given that it's all, you know, all mayhem and all mirth and mayhem
yeah.
and music.
Yeah.
What happened at the premiere? The premiere was very recently at the
yeah.
Egyptian Theater.
It was very much like I described. There was lots of carnival.
Was there fire breathing?
With the sword
that's a great
swallowing.
Place for a
yeah,
that's
yeah,
awesome.
And all that kind of stuff, and carnival barkers, and just you know what you would imagine you would see in one of those situations.
Did they have that cyclone thing that you
yeah,
the rides?
None of those rides. Thank goodness. Yeah.
Could you imagine if there were rides?
But it was a lot of fun, you know, and the films have a built-in audience already, people that are already fans, and they show
that's
up
cool.
and they dress up and they're really, you know, excited, and it's great for somebody like me who's used to the live performance
yeah.
aspect of
piece
of
cake for you, absolutely,
to get to experience a film but have a live component as well.
Do you know? Get to play and sing at all, or
not at these things?
No, that's all right. It's a little pressure, a little
yeah, yeah.
It's more fun to
I
go
just
and
show up and watch.
Yeah,
look sharp.
Yeah,
free
yeah.
food.
Yeah,
because
yeah.
you're a guitarist too.
Yeah, I play guitar. I play bass. You
cool.
know, going back to the Iron Maiden reference. I'm,
right.
I'm, again,
oh.
trying to the bastard child of Steve Harris and Bruce Dickinson.
That's so
you know.
Fierce.
Do you play that speed bass, that metal speed?
Well,
bass
you see, the thing is ding, you have ding, to ding, ding. You have to figure see the brilliance of Steve Harris
yes.
and guys like that, Frank Bello, these guys who play so fast, is they do it with two fingers. I can't get the speed, so
yeah.
I do it with three.
Oh, all right. Add another finger, speeds things along.
Exactly. You add another finger, and then it cuts
down on
yeah.
how
yeah.
many these two fingers have to do.
Right.
Yeah.
One last thing we should point out about Alleluia,
yes.
the Devil's Carnival.
Tell
and
us.
And if there's a story, please tell us.
Sure.
It co-stars David Hasselhoff.
It does.
Oh.
David Hasselhoff. Fantastic.
There can't be a story there. There just can't be.
He's so run the mill.
He and I bonded over performing in Chicago because he played in Chicago.
Oh, yeah,
that's
right.
Yeah, I don't know exactly
yeah, yeah.
where he did it. I don't think it was Broadway, but and I had just recently finished a run in Chicago. We played
Chicago
the
musical,
Chicago,
not
the
musical.
Town. Right, exactly.
Ah.
Did you see the movie with Richard Gere?
No. I did see the
okay.
movie.
So I played
good.
The
Richard
well,
Gere
the movie,
part.
Yeah,
yeah.
yeah.
yeah. That's awesome.
Yeah, and so he and I bonded over that. And he was great. He was you know, I mean, he's a really fun guy. He's very sort of self-deprecating and just
be.
A great energy yeah, to be
fun.
Around, you know. He's not at all standoffish. Actually, the original actor for that part was going to be William Shatner.
Oh, that'd be fun.
They
too.
Have a type, I guess.
Yeah, and but William Shatner,
a good swap,
he
though.
Fell off a horse.
Oh.
And ooh. So we were lucky enough to get David Hasselhoff to come in and do the part. And he did an amazing job. He sings a really great song in the film. And
I
was great.
I see that.
Yeah.
I think one of the Paul and I moved here, I think, in 2000. And right away I auditioned for a musical and I got in it. And so I was at the musical rehearsals. And this was my first brush with any sort of celebrity. Out here in L.A., you'd think it would be super pro. But you know, not necessarily. We were rehearsing at the musical director's condo. So I was in there, and I didn't know at the time that he's like a big deal because I didn't know anybody, which is good because that would have made me nervous. So we're rehearsing our little thing, and I had my little tape recorder, and I was putting my stuff together. And I was leaving, and there was a man out in the other part of the condo, and all I remember seeing is just this, this is so dirty, but all I remember seeing is this gorgeous guy in these tight jeans. And I remember going,
William Shatner.
No, David Hasselhoff. Holy shit. And I remember just I don't know why I did that thing that creepy guys do. I just worked him up from the pant, like the his boots up, and I was like,
to those blue eyes.
To the eyes, and
criticize
I was like,
me about Lake Bell. How dare you? How dare you?
I'm just this little dork doing like some Taffetas musical, and I'm like, and he knows that you know that he's David Hasselhoff.
He's the Hoff.
He's the Hoff.
But he also knows that you're in an environment where you must be there for a reason, and he's coming. He was going there to learn chess.
To
the
live
music,
again?
The music,
I think
for,
so, yeah.
The music,
I think chess.
Chess. Yeah. He was there because he was going to be going to Broadway to do it.
Chess?
No.
What
was
chess.
It? Jekyll and Hyde.
Jekyll and Hyde.
Jekyll and Hyde. Yes, Jekyll
he
and
was
Hyde,
there
yes.
Learning the tracks. The guy, the musical director. Yes. So I just checked him out and I was like, "Hi," and he goes, "Hi," and he just started talking to me to make things normal again.
Right.
Oh my God, he's gorgeous, beautiful man. That was 15 years ago, but beautiful.
Stephen Lewis ran into a celebrity once, and he's like, "Everybody, every time you run into a celebrity, you have this attitude that is, do you know who you are?"
I didn't say
it's you.
I didn't
that's
say
right, it's me.
I did that when I saw Buddy Guy. I went, "You Buddy Guy," and he walked on. I had nothing. I was like, "That's all I have."
Do you know who you are?
He was so tall, by the way, too. He was very tall.
I you know, one of the greatest things about when Rent became really successful on Broadway that first year, every celebrity came
out. Cool.
And they all came backstage to meet us because they loved the show, and it was like, so we got to meet so many fun people. And I remember meeting Jim Carrey, and he had the greatest line. I said, I walked into the alley and I saw him, and I said, "Oh my God, Jim fucking Carrey." He goes, "How'd you know my middle name?"
That's awesome.
Yeah.
You ever meet a president or anything in all this?
I have. I've met Bill Clinton.
Oh, that's
twice,
a,
actually.
That's he, a cool so one cool. To
Bill
meet.
And Hillary came to see the show. And then when I was doing Aida a few years later, I got to perform for them on a an aircraft carrier. There was like, it was like Fleet Week in on the Hudson in, you know, New York City. And they had me and some other people come out and sing
cool.
For the prez.
Yeah. Have you met Obama?
I have not.
No, that'd be cool too.
Yeah, it'd be
yeah,
great.
Good times. Yeah. Didn't want to bring that up. Sorry about that.
So Obama, if you're listening, devilscarnival.com.
That's right.
Look for the LA dates. All right,
he'll just come show on up. That would be awesome.
Adam, let me ask you what we ask every guest who comes on the show.
Yeah.
What is your favorite movie of all time?
There is a wrong answer. So
yeah. It's a hard choice.
I think I'm going to give you the wrong answer. I'm going to give you the really stock, boring, horrible
Citizen
answer.
Citizen Kane. Okay.
No. I hated that movie.
Gone with the Wind.
No. I hate to say it, but it's like I watch it every time it's on, and it remains to be my favorite movie, The Godfather.
Oh, that's a good one.
Yeah. You're the only guy to come in here naming that.
Yeah, so. I mean,
that's solid. That's totally solid.
It really is filmmaking
good.
At its best.
What's your favorite scene? What's your favorite moment? Shot.
Oh God, that's a good question. I you know what? I love the scene when Brando finds out that Sonny's been killed. And I mean, it's just
heartbreaker.
Yeah, and it's just, I mean, it's like it's such an acting lesson between the two of them. It's just it's just so visceral. It's so real, and yeah, I just loved it.
I'd never seen that until Paul won Money in a Game Show, and we went to Italy. And on the way there, we watched The Godfather. Well, it was such a long plane ride. We watched The Godfather and The Godfather 2, and then Godfather 3 in Sicily.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So we went to Corleone.
Yeah.
Oh, fantastic!
Badass. That was cool.
That says something about Godfather 3. It was a long flight, and yet, we'll skip Godfather 3. Right.
I'm just gonna stare at the back of this seat instead of actually watching this movie.
We just didn't get to it until we're in Sicily.
It was like an 8-hour flight. We only had time to watch the first two Godfathers, and then the first one again a little bit.
Favorite scene is such a hard question. I mean,
yeah, that
there's
is
no
tricky.
Doubt
yeah.
when Michael has to kill the cop in the
of course in the restaurant. Shape. That's a great.
Yeah, but the opening scene is so great. I mean, who knows?
When you say my favorite movie is Ghostbusters,
one of mine too,
right,
definitely
love it. And my favorite scene in that, the thing that really struck me when I was a kid was the scene where Ray and Winston are in the car talking about the end of the times.
Yeah, right.
And that's not even a funny scene. And boy,
it's
music,
a good scene though, yeah.
The lighting, the fact that they were talking about something I never heard of before because we weren't, you know, churchy people.
Right,
blew my mind. The fact that maybe the dead are rising. What? That got me.
Now I have a question about Ghostbusters and Godfather, okay?
Yes.
Because just over break, I watched The Big Lebowski with three different people.
Yeah,
like, I went on vacation, I watched it with my cousin, I watched it with my friend Jim, and I watched it with my mom.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And every time, that is a brand new, absolutely hilarious, in a way that's just brand new to me every time. Did you find that the Ghostbusters, every time, you're just laughing like that is the first time you've heard that joke and it caught you completely by surprise? Because that's what I do all the way through Lebowski.
It just reminds me of where I was when I first saw it, you know? And so then I just enjoy them enjoying it. Oh, and if they aren't enjoying it, then I get irritated.
Who you're watching it with?
Yeah. Then they need to just...
Yeah, I don't have time for people that don't appreciate a movie as well.
Well, I don't, also, you know, growing up in the 80s, I remember the first VCR that I had, and we had like four movies.
Yeah.
That's all I had. And so I watched those same four movies over and over again.
Over and over.
Those became my favorite movies. It was Grease, Jaws.
Yeah.
Jaws 2.
Nice.
There was another one. There was
Pretty
like
in Pink was my first one.
Yeah, that's a good one too. Yeah. But like, you know, you just, that's all you had. And so like, you just pop it in, you know.
Here's a question I would like to add to the annals of things we ask guests.
Yes?
I used to ask people, what's your cable TV movie? What's the movie you only know because HBO wouldn't stop showing it? Like a classic is Six Pack.
Clash of the Titans.
I'll go Solar Babies.
Oh, I'll tell you, Hot Stuff.
Hot Stuff.
Dom DeLuise. One of my favorites.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Hot Stuff was one of my favorites. Cannonball Run, of course.
Cannonball Run!
Yes! Like, nobody saw that in the theater. Yeah. You just saw it over and over.
Yep.
And it was that kind of movie where you could come in at any time because it's the same storyline.
They're driving.
Very true.
They're just in a different location. You're like, oh, all right.
The one I would add to that is, what were the other two movies on the tape? So if on VCR tapes, you could fit three movies, right?
Yeah.
So if I say Return of the Jedi...
Aliens and the Fly.
I had Ghostbusters right and Ghostbusters 2, and then I think I had Coming to America, because I liked when the little thing danced, the little bottle cap.
Oh, yeah,
with the little kid. The little
kid,
I like that.
Return of the Jedi, I also had Jaws and Enter the Dragon. Boom!
I think mine was...
Enter the Ninja.
Yeah, mine was Grease... Pope of Greenwich Village. And I think I think Hot Stuff was on one of them. Or actually it might have been one of the Star Wars too. Yeah.
That's so cool.
Good stuff.
All right, let's go from the greatest movies of all time and Hot Stuff to what did you see this week?
All right, are we going to make Adam
I don't
sing
have the music.
Where's
tune?
The song?
I don't know. So,
you need a theme?
I need a theme.
It could be rock and roll. We'd love that.
If only we had a professional singer.
I know.
Well, I
do you know one?
I don't know, but I do know a professional musical director that I will do my best imitation of now, because this is what happens when Mr. Letterman always needs a theme and they don't have a theme. He says, Paul, can you give me a theme? So tonight's theme is, what did you see this week? So I'll give me my Paul Shaver version. What did you see this week? What did you see this week? Yeah!
Yeah!
Thank you, Paul.
That was awesome. I love the enthusiasm.
That's the new theme song,
the greatest.
So I put it to the table.
It's the greatest.
What did you see?
All right.
I was traveling, so I will tell you right away, I saw two movies on the plane, going one way, coming back. I always kind of wanted to see The Maze Runner, so I hit The Maze Runner on the old... Now they have these great selections on the back of the chair in front of you where you can choose from like a dozen movies.
Chose The Maze Runner.
Cool. And you can pay for the new releases, or they just got some old shit in there, too.
They waited until I owned an iPad to bring that technology around.
I know, right?
Yeah, it's like, all right.
Now, for those of you who may not remember, The Maze Runner is a bunch of teenage kids who are stuck in a maze.
Yes. There are two types of young adult novels. One where two kids fall in love and then fall out of love, and one where the entire future is out to kill all teens.
This is the latter.
This is the second one. Where adults hate teens and build mazes.
It was right about what I thought it would be. It didn't overwhelm, but I wanted to see the cool maze. That's what I wanted to be. And it's a shame I missed it in the theater because it would have been a little more overwhelming.
Than the back of a plane seat?
Yeah, the back of the seat in front of me.
Okay.
Because, you know, when they get to the end and you discover what's really going on, it's okay, and it's really just setting up another movie, which comes out next month. So, you know, that left a little to be desired.
It's so weird that now they just know they're going to make that second movie, so...
Oh, the Golden Compass was so sure they had a trilogy. She's sailing off at the end. Another day, we'll fight.
And listen to how delicious we hate that. You're like, good, you got it. No, the others, everybody else is getting their sequel, but yeah.
Star Wars ended. Then we had more movies.
Anyway. Well, you know what? Batman survived George Clooney and the nipples on the Batsuit. So, you never know. You can. There's always another one. Yeah, there's always another one.
There's no stopping
On the way back
now.
From Detroit, I saw Danny Collins with Al Pacino and Bobby Cannavale and Annette Bening.
I don't know
it came and went. I thought it might have been a little awards fodder last season. But don't be fooled. It's not. It's a much more accessible sort of rated R comedy.
What's it called? I'm going
to
add it to
Danny
my list.
Danny Collins. It's about a singer who used to be a big deal back in like the 60s and 70s. Pacino plays the singer, and he pulls it off okay. He only sings a couple times in the movie, so he most of the time just has to be like this aging rock star with a scarf and glasses. And,
you know, when you do that, your eyes start to cross.
You don't have to name your movie Danny Collins just because the guy's named Danny. That's a boring name.
It kind of is.
That's why I wouldn't go see Michael Collins or Captain Phillips. I mean, just,
I'd go see Phil Collins.
That's a boring name for a pirate movie.
Such a great movie.
It's a pirate movie. You're so stupid.
But
it is a pirate movie.
The character's true beginning to end for Danny, and he has to, you know, sort of... Something happens, which is in the plot, which I wish it wasn't, because the interesting thing... It's very interesting what happens to him that causes him to sort of say, I'm doing too much blow, and, you know, it's late in my
life. It's always something interesting that makes you say that.
And then, man, this is a really good ending. So,
that's the first I've heard of it. I mean, it's an Al Pacino. And,
it's like a change of world. It's not awards fodder because it's not breaking any.
It's no Godfather.
It's really amazing what the world of film has become in that you have all of these movies with these huge movie stars like Al Pacino and like... And they come out and nobody even knows that they're out.
Yeah, right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because they don't get a release in any sort of traditional way. It's like they come and they go, and then you see them on Netflix. You're like, when did that movie get made?
Yeah, I did that last night. What is that? Oh, I'll watch that.
Yeah. I mean, I guess, you know, he's in his twilight years. I mean, it's still a lot of these actors, they do kind of come and go. What was the one, Robert Redford? He's got one coming out where he hikes across... Yeah. the country with another actor,
right.
I think.
And then he's in Winter Soldier. So they do. Yeah, with Nick Nolte.
Yeah,
we'll talk about that next week.
All right. Sure.
And the last thing we saw this together was Hot Pursuit.
Hot Pursuit.
With Reese Witherspoon.
We watched that.
Is it charming at all?
No.
Yeah.
It looked like it wanted to be, but.
You know what's a sad thing is I think that the movie does a disservice to the stars because I think they have a lot of good chemistry and they're funny and they know how to deliver funny things. Sadly, no one gave them funny things to deliver.
I hate a misused talent.
They were both good.
I hate that.
I'm going to say a quick story about when we went, Adam Witt and I, when we went to the
there's so many Adam
premiere of
Cool name when you were a kid or stupid name when you were a kid?
When I was younger, I kind of wanted to change it.
I caught shit.
I wish my name was Mark. Like, I just picked some random name.
And that's the stupid thing, too. I went to school with all these, like, biblical kids who are all named Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and they're making fun of my name. And I'm like, mine's in the Bible, too. What are you talking about?
Before
mine's
yours.
Like, any sense.
Mine is the shit in the Bible.
Mine is the shit.
There is no Mark Method without me.
Yeah, right?
Never got that. I'm like,
We saw, speaking of the Bible, we saw the Evan Almighty premiere, right? And we were watching the movie, and there was a scene where, like, Evan's kids are doing something crazy, and then Evan comes in the room and deals with some sort of plot point. He has to tell a family.
Yeah.
But when the kids were doing something, you leaned over and he said, Apatow would have done something funny there.
You know,
he would have taken 2 seconds to do something funny before he comes in. Then something funny is in the script, so you get an extra funny.
Right.
The Hot Pursuit is missing that all over the place. There's a scene that ends... They're done with the plot that needed to happen, and they just cut away slowly. I'm like,
it's like watching an SNL sketch that doesn't have an ending.
Put a tag on that.
Yeah. Okay. FYI, I went to high school with Judd Apatow.
Did you really?
Oh, cool.
Oh, that's so cool.
Syosset High School. Yeah.
Wow.
I want to read his book.
That's cool.
Yeah. He just wrote a book where he his whole life.
Oh, yeah,
I have it. Did you know him as interviewing comedians way back then?
Yeah, what was his...
I actually probably knew him before that because... I was really good friends with his sister, Mia. She and I were the same age. Judd is a few years older than me. And so I think he graduated in 84, and I graduated in 88. But I used to hang out at his house all the time with his sister Mia, and they had this little sort of like hidden room in their house.
Oh, that's cool.
And Mia and I and this other girl, Wendy, we used to cut school and hide in this little, like almost like a closet.
I love this whole store. I'm having a sex thing though, in my head.
But their father was home. And
what?
So instead of going to school, we would hide in this little cubby basically and be completely silent for hours. Like we were like Anne Frank in the fucking
did he know that?
And then so I like, and that was more fun than going to school. It was like hiding silently in this closet in the
room. Did he know you were there at all?
No, I think by that time he was probably gone out of the house.
Oh, that's hysterical.
Yeah, because his book, he's apparently been interviewing comedians his whole life. He'll do some whatever it takes, call people to get to whoever.
And being that he was a kid, he got a lot of access.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, so he's loved it his whole life.
Who was they were just talking about on Stern? He had interviewed. Was it Seinfeld? Who did he interview?
He's interviewed Seinfeld. Yeah, yeah. I think he might have talked.
Oh
about
yeah, the
Brooks.
Book's great. The book's got everybody in it. Yeah. Even Michael O'Donoghue.
But anyway, Hopper
cool.
Suit. Hopper
that's
Suit misses out on all the funny that Apatow could have brought.
The point is,
and those two women were really funny.
Yeah,
that's a shame.
I saw, you know, there's nothing I love quite like a ramp up. I watched Mission Impossible 1 through 5.
Adam likes, if there's
Rogue
more
Nation.
Than three of a movie, no matter what it is, even the ones with the romance with her, what were those?
Twilight.
He's
Twilight,
watched all
yeah.
of them. Once they make more than three, I don't know, he'll watch them.
Yeah. I'm a big fan of the Mission Impossible films.
Yeah, I mean, that's
oh,
not, much, that's not
yes.
much torture.
No, that's not torture.
That is not torture except for two. Two is incredible torture, but hilarious. It is the Batman Forever of Mission Impossible movies. It's almost, you know, it's pretty good, but there's just so much weird stuff in it. It's so funny to watch John Woo just be John Woo at the time. By the way, and I think this is this is a movie rule for me, okay? I say adjust your expectations, know what you're getting into, and try to like the movie, right? That's your job as a viewer. It's not all on them, for God's sakes.
Hallelujah.
Here's an Adam Witt patented movie rule. Do not be surprised by the number of doves in a John Woo movie. That's on you, right?
Yeah, just like don't be surprised if there's a laser flare in that other guy's movie.
J.J. Abrams.
Yeah.
Go to a J.J. Abrams movie. Don't be surprised at the number of lens flares.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You're wrong. Yeah. Not J.J. Abrams.
Because that's his art. That's like going to see Jafria and expecting to hear the Big Bad Voodoo Daddy. Yeah. That's not his style.
But this Mission Impossible Rogue Nation, familiar material, kind of spy wise.
Yes,
but
everybody is disavowed once again. Yeah.
But
he's their best agent, and they keep kicking him out.
They kick him out every movie. Yeah. And in between
like
every movie, I guess everything was fine.
It's like Quincy. Every week he solves the problem, but then the next week they're like, he's crazy.
Oh, Jack Bauer. Too.
What is? Yeah. Why would we listen to him?
He's only saved the world eight times.
Yeah, I mean,
get Bauer out of here.
Everything's fine at the end of Mission Impossible 4, and everything at the beginning of Mission Impossible 5 was fine. So in between that is technically a movie that is like the TV show was. Yeah. And then they just
disbanded. But that's the thing. Familiar material though, with like huge set pieces, like the Vienna, motorcycle chase, the opening, the underwater sequence. I mean, just one after the other, huge. Like how we're gonna set standards here, you know?
And Chris McQuarrie, I love this guy so much, and I've really paid a lot of attention to him. I met him years ago, and I just like became a little obsessed with him. And he did not get his due for a long time, and then it slowly sort of built up. And so his signature is all over these things. He's worked on Jack Reacher The Wolverine. I just watched The Wolverine. He wrote a draft of that. But Rogue Nation, the cool stylistic thing is you've got their big action sequences, and you've got all these huge things in the motorcycle chase, and then the economy of the last scene is just people sneaking around and running around corners and trying to avoid each other in columns and pillars, and you know, it's just people against people. It's like it's the alternate thing, because he does this in Way of the Gun as well. It just comes down to people against people in this cool way. So I love that the end of the movie is just like hiding from each other, or running around corners, or trying to, you know, tunnel chases.
Or hiding in a room
stuff.
In someone's house instead of going to school.
That's right.
There you go.
Exactly what it's like.
That's all it was missing from your adventures, Dan.
That's right. Dun. Any kind of excitement. That's what was missing.
See anything this week?
I did. I saw It Follows.
Oh, I've heard such good things. Like
what is that? What is that?
That is this horror movie about this girl that contracts a sexually transmitted curse.
Nice.
Cool. What a cool idea.
Love it.
And it has this amazing synth-inspired score, which...
Ooh, like Goblin?
which totally is one of the best things about the movie, as far as I'm concerned, is the score. It's just, it's awesome. It's really great.
Cool.
But what's really interesting is that I read an article today about Quentin Tarantino's take on the film.
Ooh.
And he said and after I read the article, I was like, yeah, you're right. I feel that way too, which is that it was a really, really good movie, but it almost made you angry because it could have been great. And he points out that the director kept not sticking to his own sort of mythology that he sets up in the beginning of the movie.
Yeah.
So as the movie progresses, he deviates from what he set up, and it kind of doesn't make sense, and you almost don't notice it. It's almost like sort of subliminal, and then by the end, all of these things that he had set up kind of go away, and all of these other things end up happening, and it left me a little bit empty. But I did love the movie. I thought it was really great and very clever. And
who directed that?
I don't know the guy's name.
No, do you know?
I think he's like a first time.
We crapped over all of him.
Yeah,
anyway.
I have no idea.
Wow.
We crapped on him anyway.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh,
and I saw the Mad Max Fury Road.
Nice.
Which was great.
On a small screen? Because now it's digital, right?
Well, I saw it on in a hotel.
Well, there you go. He didn't at least see it on the back of a chair.
No.
You know, that one I think requires a little more.
Did lose a little.
But I was a huge fan of the movies, the Mel Gibson versions.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought Tom Hardy was awesome. The movie
was
great.
Really great.
George Romero is just, I mean, nobody makes movies like that.
George Miller.
I'm sorry, George Miller.
Have you heard the rumor?
What?
George Miller for Man of Steel 2.
Oh, wow.
It's out there. It's a rumor.
All right, I'll take it. I'll take a good rumor like that, a good tasty one. I can't believe how he kept the energy after a 20-year absence from that movie.
Yeah, and it just, I mean, he has such a distinctive style, and he doesn't, it's one of those action movies that doesn't rely on so much CGI. I mean, there's real shit going on.
Thank God, it makes it more exciting.
It really does. Yeah. If you do it well, it's better. Mm-hmm. It's really better.
Yeah. Now, one thing I will say, what's interesting about that movie is that, you know, comparing it, I would like to compare it to Indiana Jones and the King of the Crystal Skull. Did we discuss this already?
No.
That it is, there is a ton of CGI in that movie. It is in every frame of Mad Max. Yes, they took it out on the road. Yes, I've seen all the EPKs where they actually drove with him in the front of the blah, 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 blah. But every inch of that is touched in CGI in some way and messed with. And I just think it's so interesting because that movie got such for being a fourth movie in a series by the same director, that movie got such credit for still being cool because it's all in how you do the CGI.
And that brings you to the Crystal Skull, which was not cool.
Exactly.
And not
but,
well done.
But we
I
used
see.
To say, oh, we hate it because he put CGI in our Raiders of the Lost Ark movie.
But he just didn't do it well.
But George Miller put CGI in our Road Warrior movie, and we should hate that. But instead, nobody even mentioned it.
Yeah.
But you're right. It's the way it's used.
It's the way it's done.
He didn't lead with
such a good lesson.
Miller didn't lead with a CGI gopher laughing at all of Mad Max is doing.
Well, that's true, too. I mean, I think that provides the ultimate analysis of what's wrong with the fourth in an Indiana Jones series, which had started without any CGI. And it stopped taking itself seriously. It started making jokes out of everything, and Mad Max never did.
And for the record, 30 years since Thunderdome.
Yeah, and Spielberg couldn't keep the tone straight from Raiders to Temple of Doom.
I know. That flew off the rails early, that whole franchise.
All right, I'm going to do just one because I saw a bunch of movies when Paul's out of town. Because what else is there to do? I'm going to talk about Vacation.
Oh,
I saw that
shit.
In the theaters.
You saw the remake.
All right, I'm going to just set this up I'm going to set this up real fast because I think it's important to know the situation I was going into the movie from. My car broke down. Paul was out of town. The very next day, my car breaks down. I have no money. So you're kind of like, oh, life is sucks. But I get the car to the place to fix it.
I want to go laugh. Let's go to Pixels.
Exactly. So my friend Mike Nichols, not that Mike Nichols, the one that's still alive.
No,
Mike Nichols.
No, Legal Eagles.
No, friend of the show. He picks me up in North Hollywood. And
Ivan Reitman.
Ivan Reitman, that's right. So he picks me up and... I get in the car and I'm like, well, I have to go home and feed the dog. Thank you for picking me up. And so we go home and I'm like, hey, can we go see a movie? So we were going to see Ricky and the Flash because of MoviePass, which is this great invention. It's amazing. You'll have to check it out. So I say, no, you know what?
Movie a day.
They won't let me see it because I just saw a movie 24 hours ago, but I need to see one at a different time. So can we go
see? You have to wait an hour.
Vacation. So we're like, okay, well, that won't be awful. And my car can't be, you know, it'll be sad. Okay, I loved it. It was fantastic. fantastic.
Oh, really?
It was so
I wasn't expecting that.
Good.
I was not expecting
that. Right. Yeah. I was
that
already.
That setup was almost yeah. like. I, so right. I just went back to my broken down car. It was
yeah,
more fun.
Yeah.
No.
The 80s comedy.
I was in a horrible mood, and I went to see him because I love Chevy Chase, and I'm very much
sure.
a purist of this stuff.
Yeah.
And they captured the things that they did not. Mike and I both agreed that what happened to that movie was poor marketing, and it's really
okay.
a shame because they show you the people in the shit, right?
Yeah. Oh, I know.
It's not
that's
important
annoying.
In the movie.
Yeah.
They show you the girl coming up alongside and getting unmercilessly just hit by an oncoming vehicle. That's not even funny. Uncomfortable.
Yeah.
That happens and it goes away. Even Ed Helms seems to be uncomfortable with it. Like, well, that was odd. Why did we see that?
Yeah.
So they could have cut that. They could have cut the shit, and literally cut the shit. And it was wonderful. It captured the heart. The thing is, and this is why those Clark Griswold movies are so amazing, is I know that this isn't trendy right now, but he loves his family.
Mm.
He loves his wife, and he wants his family to be happy. So he works at a job he doesn't like and doesn't think of it as suffering because he wants to be able to have his family go do great things. And so in the end, everything he does and all the mistakes he makes is completely because of unselfish reasons, because he loves his family. And I almost cried when I watched it. And then, of course, Chevy Chase shows up and he loves his son, who is Ed Helms. And he and his wife love each other. And they all do everything the best they can, like we do every day, because we're trying to make life the best we can. And I know that doesn't seem like that's what that movie is going to be about.
Yeah.
Awesome movie. Absolutely romantic comedy. Fantastic. All of them are great in it. The
that
kids are
makes
awesome.
Me happy.
She called and told me that, and it shocked me, but I can totally see how they just,
yeah.
oh, we better put out the gross out jokes
but,
so
I
people
know.
Come.
But you
yeah.
cut that from the movie, and it so doesn't need any of that.
Well, I know it had the potential because he's a great recast of Clark Griswold.
He was
he's a
so
great
good.
Idea for Clark Griswold. Yeah.
He could be the kid. Absolutely.
Yeah.
I have no problem with that. And they go and they see Audrey, who's played by Bart, the other movie guy.
Leslie Mann.
Favorite actress, Leslie Mann. And there's something interesting about her character.
Oh.
Because she has a bit of a secret that later, I forgot that Chevy Chase was going to show up. And then later he shows up and tells us about it. And then when they finally get the car, I got all excited. They start playing
they
Holiday
get,
Road.
Because they get the old car, right?
Well, they have to because their car, something bad happens to it, and they're all just giving up, and they're not going to make it to Wally World.
Oh,
and they
wow.
go to stay with the parents. And Clark's like, don't worry about it. I got it. So he goes out, and he gives him the
That
car.
Is the 80s comedy equivalent of lighting that flare in Jurassic World, right?
Yeah.
That is a lighting the flare. That's good. That,
it was
you
really
know how to
good.
Do your moves. That movie knows how to be nostalgic.
Maybe I was in a bad mood because of my car, but I felt awesome when I was like done. I was like, oh my God.
Sweet.
Yeah. Hang on to the other
awesome
movies
to
you
hear.
Saw for
I'm
next
going.
Week.
Yeah.
But
it
you,
was good.
You will lead the next time so we can get all these movies.
Oh, yeah.
in. Because yeah, Karen watched like 5 movies while
yeah.
I was out of town.
I am movie passing vacation now.
There
it's really
go.
Good. Mm-hmm. Just ignore the things that are dumb.
Right. But Karen, you can keep going because we're going to end
birthdays.
The show the best
yes.
way we know
so
how.
So we can let Adam go home.
Our weekly celebration of the birthdays of those who make the movies. It's Karen's birthdays, so hit it.
Hit it. All right, let's start off our week of birthdays by wishing a very happy birthday to Melissa McCarthy. She
Hello.
Turns 45, but can play anywhere from a bridesmaid to a Ghostbuster.
Yeah.
Now, I didn't.
I hope it's good.
I have a feeling because Bill Murray's now going to show up
How's
in it.
How's that not going to be good?
I have a feeling that means he checked it out and made sure it was going to be okay, and now he's given his little stamp
yeah,
of
once
approval.
Once Aykroyd's out of the picture, all right, now I'll do it.
Now,
boy, that says everything.
Now, I don't know much about Melissa McCarthy until I saw Bridesmaids, so I went and I thought all this time that maybe she was like an overnight sensation.
Hey.
That's what I'm trying to say. Success and sensation, but.
Those take 20 years.
Exactly. She was a series regular on the Gilmore Girls for 8 years before
Holy
starring
shit.
In her own show, Mike and Molly, since 2010. Before that, she made her film debut in 1997
Whoa.
On her cousin Jenny McCarthy's show, The Jenny McCarthy Show. And she was a regular at The Groundling for 10 years. A regular for 10 years
wow.
on their Sunday company before finally filming, I don't know, what now our Ghostbusters remake, reboot. I don't even know what they're calling
yeah.
it. I hope that Vacation is a sign that it can be done and done well. And anyway, the one thing I want to tell you, Paul, is that her character's name is Abby Yates.
Mm-hmm.
And I kind of hope that's a good sign because we had a friend that they call her Yates in the movie.
Oh, great.
So we had a friend in college who is the coolest person. She's so friggin' cool. Her name's Yates. I hope
Jennifer
that's a good
Yates,
sign,
yes,
Ms.
Yeah.
Jennifer Yates. So I think this is funny. On IMDb, the plot synopsis for Ghostbusters is as follows. It is unknown at this time.
Nice.
That was as of yesterday. So I hope they figure it out.
Stick him in a containment.
Let's hope so. Next up, let's wish a very happy birthday to Mr. Armie Hammer. His real name is Armand, by the way. He turns 28. Weird. You may know him as playing anywhere from an identical twin to a Lone Ranger. Currently, he is starring in The Man from U.N.C.L.E., and he is indeed the great-grandson of industrialist and art collector and philanthropist, Mr. Armand Hammer, who founded Accidental Petroleum. And I have a retraction.
So weird.
I think last week we were talking about Man from U.N.C.L.E., and I said that he was named after the baking soda, Armie Hammer. He wasn't. It turns out that, in fact, in the 1980s, Armie Hammer's great-grandfather, Armand Hammer, owned a considerable amount of stock in Church & Dwight, the company that does manufacture Armand Hammer. But he also served on the board of directors. But that name of the company was originated long before he was even involved in it. So it was 31 years before Hammer was even born.
I know, but it was named after the product Arm & Hammer, right?
Well, it wasn't named after his father.
Yeah, I thought he was part of the family. I thought he was just a trust fund kid.
It already had a name.
I only say that because his last name is Hammer, and no one's ever been named Armie before.
Well, it's short for his grandfather's name, Armand. It's such a huge friggin' crazy coincidence. Anyway, so that's exciting. And he grew up just like the rest of us.
Anyway, here he is.
No, that's okay. He said in IMDb, I love art. You're going to love this, Adam. I love art. I used to have a painting of Gorbachev that was given to my family by Gorbachev. So he's just like us.
I love when rich kids grow up to be famous movie stars.
I know. It
makes
just
me feel really good.
Makes me great.
Yes.
This cosmic thing is working.
It's all the training. He spent the better part of his formative years in the Cayman Islands after his father saw the movie The Firm.
I'm starting to hate him.
But this, Adam, this explains why I spent the better part of my formative years in Western New York, because my dad was a big fan of Deliverance. Thank you, Adam, for laughing at my stupid joke. And lastly, Paul, you know how much I love when celebrities sing.
Yeah, it's true. You love when celebrities sing. So no doubt Armie Hammer sings?
No. Nope. Armie Hammer doesn't sing, and Melissa McCarthy doesn't sing.
He barely acts.
And yeah, but even though
I wanted to slip that knife in one more time, thank you for going back there.
Even though our friend of the show, Mr. Adam Pascal, does not have a birthday until October, I think.
Oh. That's true.
28th.
25th.
I didn't have it memorized, but in case anyone out there wants to hear him singing a little something,
I do.
I know, right? I went and I pulled something I loved. I thought this was cool. This is from School of Rock, where you're playing Theo. Sure. Do you remember that happening?
I sure do.
Yes, and
do you remember your life?
He was a frontman for a great named band called No Vacancy.
Yeah,
and he's singing "Heal Me, I'm Heartsick." Here he is, a little Mr. Adam Pascal. It takes a second to get going, so if you want to talk over it for a second.
Yeah, so Linklater.
Yeah,
Could you tell he was
Richard?
This amazing director?
I could. I could tell.
He already had a great
bunch
of stuff.
He did, but you know, you can tell so much by the tone on the set. Because the director sets the tone and the star
like Chris
sets
Columbus
the tone.
Does one tone.
Wait, what movie?
This was School of Rock.
Oh, School of Rock. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Oh.
And
that's awesome.
And he just he has such a
Schoolhouse Rock. Sorry.
He's such a regular guy.
That was me. I did school.
Who's just a really talented director. Like, he's just such an unassuming regular dude, and like you know, this was a big movie, kids all over the place, like, yeah. You know, I mean, it was just like a lot of hectic things going on, and he was just always calm and cool and approachable and just a really, really great
Adam
director.
Listen to this. You can hear like the Bruce Dickinson influence. Jeff Tate.
The drowning ocean.
Yeah.
Snuff the sun in motion is a pill on my tongue.
Right?
A shot from a
That's badass.
All right, that wraps another movie showcast, everybody. Wow. Together, we're the movie guys. Individually, we are.
Adam.
You can follow us on Twitter at The Movie Guys for daily jokes and links. Also, Facebook.com/TheMovieGuys, as well as iTunes, Vimeo, YouTube, Funny or Die, SoundCloud, Vine, Instagram, all that shit. Thanks to Adam Pascal.
Yay!
Hey, thanks, guys. Thanks for having me. Thank you.
Where can we find you? Do you do
keep
the social
at it.
Media
keep
thing?
At it, man. You're
you
going to
find
make
me
it.
In my.
Yeah, one of these days, someone's going to realize your talent.
You can find me, I guess, on Facebook. Yeah, I don't tweet and I don't do any of that.
You got a
stuff.
Fan page on there so people can like
it. I have a website too, adampascal.net.
This is success. You don't if you don't have a Twitter account because you don't need that.
No.
He doesn't need that.
It's that I have in the past put my foot in my mouth time, and so I try and avoid as many outlets as I can to do that anymore. So.
The next movie he's in is with Armie Hammer.
Yeah,
and he's like, hey, wait a second, you listen to the movie guys? What?
Also check out KarenVolpe.com, the BooBaySisters.com.
Yes, we have a big show for Labor Day next Saturday. We're going to be at Corky's Cork Lounge singing dirty songs about going downtown. So come on over.
That's Karen's singing trio. DigitalMindProductions.com and more. And thanks to Steve Schultz for his writing contributions to the show every week. And as always, we owe everything to Pat Peach. Next week, we head into Labor Day weekend with Hollywood apparently not giving a shit, as we'll only have the Transformer Refueled new in theaters. Although we'll probably talk about that Nick Nolte and Robert Redford Go Hiking movie. And we will see you then.
That would be a better title for it. I think that's the Transporter Refueled, not Transformer Refueled.
The Transporter. Thank you. I woke up in Detroit
Transporter.
This morning. Thanks to all of you here at the table for picking up the slack on my energy, because I jet lag. Thanks for listening. I'm haunted.